Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saves my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. What a sacrifice that saves my life. Good morning, everybody. That's nice and loud. Welcome to everybody that's here and is watching online. I must remember to look over there as well. It's good to be back. I've had a little break. I can't tell you where we've been together as a family. All I can say, it was by the seaside. So that's all I'm going to say. It was very nice, though, and it's good to be with you this morning as we join together. As I said last time, I was leading. I'm far enough away for me not to need a mask at this stage, but when it comes to the prayer over communion, I will then put a mask on because I'm aware I'll be potentially breathing over the elements. So I will put my mask on then, and when it comes to serving communion, I will have gloves on. So everything will be as safe as it needs to be. But with all that in mind, and in these unusual days that we're living in at the time, I had a look at one of the set psalms for this morning, which is Psalm 124. And I'm going to read this by way of encouragement to remind us that we're in the hands of God. And this is written by David in the context of conflict, recognizing that it's God who has delivered him out of all his troubles. Him meaning himself and Israel. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel say. If the Lord had not been on our side when men attacked us, when their anger flared against us, they would have swallowed us alive. The flood would have engulfed us. The torrents would have swept over us. The raging waters would have swept us away. Praise be to the Lord. It was not let us be torn by their teeth. We have escaped like a bird out of the fowler's snare. The snare has been broken and we have escaped. And then it's this final verse as we come to worship today. Let this be our focus. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Let's pause for a moment's quiet and then we will begin our service as it appears on the screen. Come, Holy Spirit, we ask in the name of Jesus, minister to our hearts, our minds, our wills, our souls this day. Fill us, feed us, and strengthen us to be your witnesses in this world at this time. In that wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
As we come to our Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, the one who keeps us, we come to him confessing our need of him through our failures, through our weakness, with the opportunity to come back to him knowing that he is full of forgiveness and mercy. Christ, the light of the world, has been raised from the dead to dispel the darkness of our hearts. Let us confess our sins. Lord, through your self-giving love, you bring God's pardon and peace to our broken lives. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, by your Holy Spirit, you bring us into the heavenly family. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, by your resurrection, you raise us from death to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May God our Father forgive us our sins and bring us to the fellowship of his table through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so, as we continue to worship, we now have our readings from the Scriptures.
Chapter 51, verses 1-6. So that's Isaiah, chapter 51, verses 1-6. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness and who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were cut and the quarry from which you were hewn. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who gave you birth. When I called him, he was but one, and I blessed him and made him many. The Lord will surely comfort Zion and will look with compassion on all her ruins. He will make her deserts like Eden, her wastelands like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and sound of singing. Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. The law will go from me. My justice will become a light to the nations. My righteousness draws near speedily. My salvation is on the way, and my arm will bring justice to the nations. The islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. Lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look at the earth beneath. The heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and its inhabitants die like flies. But my salvation will last forever. My righteousness will never fail.
Good morning. Our second reading is from the New Testament, and it's in Matthew 16, verses 13 to 20. Matthew 16, verses 13 to 20. I'm reading for the New International Version. Peter's Confession of Christ. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Morning to all those who are joining us online. It's great to have you with us. I envy you. You'll be sat there with a cup of tea. I've only got water. A very good friend of mine, who's not a million miles away from here, knew that I was sort of wrestling with these scriptures this morning. And being a good friend, she said to me, "You've only got 10 minutes, you know. Don't go on." It's nice to be encouraged in that way, isn't it? So anyway, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. Lord, speak to us this morning. Touch us by your Holy Spirit and enlighten our hearts with what you have for us this morning. I pray that, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, I'm not going to claim that everything that I say this morning is my original thinking. It's a summary of things that I've read and I've heard about these scriptures. In actual fact, you could do a series on either of these scriptures or any of the scriptures that are set for this morning. Amazing, the word of God. But I'm offering my thoughts to you as an encouragement to those at home, to those sat here. So I want to talk to you this morning about ISA. No, don't. You can see they're switching off. If you're at home, you don't know. There's a glazed eye expression come over some of these in here. When I talk about ISA, I'm not talking about a financial investment. I'm talking about our ISA in Jesus Christ. ISA. Identity, security, and authority. In our reading from Matthew's Gospel, Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people think that he is? What do they say of me?" That's what he's asking them. And in the Sunday link this week, which I've used to send out the newsletters to folk, it says that if you'd asked an ordinary Jewish person, or even a Jewish scholar in the first century, what they expected of the Messiah, they would be unlikely to say that he would be the Son of God. I have a neighbour who is Jewish, and we have really good conversations, and I did ask her this question, actually, and she, like many Jews, are still waiting for the Messiah. And she describes Jesus as a prophet, a good person. And this is similar to the answers that the disciples give to Jesus. People think that you're John the Baptist. They think you're Elijah. They think you're Jeremiah. They think you're one of the prophets. But what about you? Jesus asked. Who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." In other words, Simon Peter declares that he recognizes that Jesus is divine, the promised Messiah, the Savior. He declares Jesus' true identity. Now, this can be said to be a light bulb moment for Simon Peter. As Jesus says, "Blessed are you, Simon, for this wasn't revealed to you by flesh and blood. It wasn't revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." In other words, it's a divine revelation. In a group discussion that I was involved with in the last couple of weeks, we were discussing the question, how do you hear from God? Now, we weren't necessarily talking about hearing a voice, but how do we know when God is speaking to us or revealing something to us? Jesus recognizes that Simon Peter has heard from God. And the question that is also before us about Jesus, who do we say that he is? We who say that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, our Savior, we commit our lives to following him. And we find our identity in him. One of the songs that we've sung here has the words, I am who you say I am. I am who God says I am. I am a child of God. And that's true for every person in this place today and those at home. Our identity is in Jesus Christ. No matter what words have been said about us or over us, no matter what other people say about us, my identity, your identity, is determined in Jesus Christ. Each one of us who belong to him. Now, this is not zealous optimism. It's the truth. And God's word affirms it. God so loved the world, you and I, that he sent Jesus to die for our sins and to rise again. We are created anew. We are spiritually reborn in Jesus. And Jesus goes on in the gospel and says to Simon, I tell you that you are Peter. In Greek, that's Petros. And on this rock, in Greek, Petra. It's a play on words. I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I, Jesus Christ, will build my church. And the gates of death, the gates of hell, the gates of Hades, whatever translation you use, will not prevail against it. This is such a significant scripture. Every part of scripture I know is. But here Peter recognizes Jesus' true identity, and Jesus in turn declares Peter's identity. He's going to lead the church that Jesus builds. A new community of believers through whom God will act in this world. In the Old Testament, God called out Abram. He changed his name to Abraham, and he gave him the promise that he would be the father of a multitude. And in the Isaiah reading from chapter 51, Abraham is the rock from which the people of God are quarried. Simon, similarly, has his name changed to Peter, and like Abraham, he has a unique role because of his faith in Jesus. He becomes someone God uses to establish a new people. You and I, the church, we're here today because of that faith. So going back to those words from Isaiah 51, look to the rock from which you were cut, and to the quarry from which you were hewn. We are part of the body of Christ, the church. We are quarried from the rock of faith, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against us. We are an end time people. We will come under attack from the powers and principalities of darkness, but the church of Jesus Christ will emerge victorious because of what he's already done. We have eternal security. And we have authority. Jesus gives Peter the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Now, keys can be used to lock or unlock. And some may think that this is a bit of a negative picture, that keys represent power used in a negative way, used more to lock out than to unlock and throw open. But with Jesus' resurrection, the gates of heaven were opened wide. All who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's what God's word says. We believe it. We embrace it. We take that to heart. And all who call on the name of the Lord are welcomed into his kingdom. We cannot decide to open or close the kingdom of heaven. That's God's power. But God uses us to help others to find their way into the kingdom. I won't go into song now, but I had "Consider Yourself at Home" in my head when I was writing this. Consider yourself at home. Consider yourself part of the furniture. You belong to the kingdom of God. I spoke earlier about a group discussion where I took part in the question, how do we hear from God? How and when do we get the divine light bulb moments? One person in the group, a good friend, had very serious doubts that she'd ever heard from God. And then later that week realized that he did reveal something quite amazing to her. She was out walking on the promenade early one morning and looking around her with completely new eyes, saw the beauty that was around her. She saw the sea. She felt the fresh air. She saw the hills to the north and the view to the south. And it came to her, and she shared with me, so many negative things are said about Blackpool and over Blackpool. It's true, we do top some of the wrong league tables. But this week also, as I was driving round, there was an incredible rainbow. I don't know if you saw it, but I saw the full arc of the rainbow over Blackpool. God speaks hope over this town. In Jesus Christ, he speaks hope over every man, woman, and child of our community. He speaks hope over you who are sat at home. Speaks hope to every one of you here. There is a blessing that God wishes to pour out on this community. So I encourage you this week to remember your ISA. Be confident in who God says you are. Faith in Jesus Christ gives us our true identity. It gives us solid, eternal security. And he gives us the authority to prevail. So I would ask you this week, everyone, please be open to what God is saying to you. Please be open to those light bulb moments. And one of the things that we have been doing is speaking words of blessing over our community. They're here on the board, on this map that is our parish. And if you can, if anybody can remember it, those at home and those here, I'd like to finish speaking those words of blessing and being inclusive, because we are gathering in everyone. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. The Lord turn his face towards us and give us peace. Amen.
Thank you, Vicky. And so, reflecting on the ISA, if we think about investment, and God gives us the greatest investment of all, He withholds nothing from us. He gives us His Son, Jesus Christ, that we could be reconciled, brought back to our Father in heaven, our Lord and our God. We now declare our faith as we remain seated, as the words appear on the screen, and then we will have a short time of prayer. Let us confirm our faith in the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Father, thank you that you invest your precious Son, that we will be saved. A salvation that starts in this life and continues for all eternity. We give you thanks for our town of Blackpool. And as we pray your blessing over this town, we pray that many would have their hearts opened and turn to you. And that when people speak of Blackpool in the future, they would say, that's the place where I met with God. Because of your favour and because of your blessing. May this be a place of healing and deliverance and restoration. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for those today for whom this is a difficult day. We remember those who are grieving. We remember those who are in hospital. We remember families who cannot access their loved ones because of the restrictions or because of their own self-isolation. We pray that you would reveal yourself as the healer, the restorer, the sustainer, and the deliverer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for those who for them today is a struggle because of financial difficulties. We think of those who have lost jobs, for those who have an uncertain future because of businesses not reopening and the difficulties around COVID-19 and the implications on the economy. And so we pray for families in this parish and for those, Lord, who need your provision, that you would stretch out your hand in generosity and that people would know that the blessing has come from you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for your church here at home, wherever your people gather. We thank you for this community of St. Thomas's. We pray that your church will grow and that you'll pour out your blessing upon us and that more people will be gathered into your kingdom. But these are strange times. And so as we pray to you, we remember those for whom this is difficult because we cannot have fellowship in the way we used to, sharing tea or coffee or food. We can't share the peace as we used to. And that lack of human contact, for those who struggle, we pray for your strength and your blessing at this time. But Lord, through all of this, may your church be strengthened and may our faith grow for your honour, for your praise and for your glory. Lord, in your mercy. In a moment's quiet, let's bring to the Lord in our hearts those things upon our own hearts this day. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
We collect for today. O Lord, from whom all good things come, grant to us, your humble servants, that by your holy inspiration we may think those things that are good, and by your mercy guiding may perform the same. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our prayers by saying, Most merciful Lord, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we are at the point in the service where, knowing the forgiveness of God, hearing his word, gathering round this table, we know we have peace with our Heavenly Father. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, Peace be with you. Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Christ, be always with you.
And also with you.
So let's share the peace. Chuck the peace around. Have some peace. Have some peace at home. As we continue to share the peace, I will go through the process of sanitation. The Lord is here.
Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell. And restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise and opened the gate of life eternal. And so, in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, and we obey his command. Send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread and he gave it to them and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with St. Thomas and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. We join together in the words that Jesus taught his disciples as we say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. And so, as you are guided, please do come forward as we share in this Holy Communion together. The body and blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body and blood of Christ keep you in eternal life.
Goodness.
So as we give thanks to God, we pray. God of truth, we have seen with our eyes and touched with our hands the bread of life. Strengthen our faith that we may grow in love for you and each other. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord. Amen. God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of everlasting life. Amen. God the Son, who in bursting forth from the grave, ascended on high and sent the Holy Spirit, give you joy as you share the faith. Amen. God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Have a great week, folks. I'll escape to the door so I can say farewell to you, but at a distance.
Before your radiant lips arise, how long